Hello, everyone. My name is Mark Hallett, and I'm the director of the Paul Mellon Centre for Studies in British Art. I'd like to offer you the warmest of welcomes to this autumn's public lecture course, or the beginning of this autumn's public lecture course, which is devoted to the subject of Black British artists and political activism, and which has been convened by tonight's speaker, Dr. Lizzie Robles from the University of Bristol. Before we get properly started, we thought it'd be helpful to provide you with some basic information about the event, some housekeeping information. Here we are, and I'll just read through this. So Lizzie's lecture will be followed by an opportunity to ask questions. So I think Lizzie will be speaking for about 50 minutes or so. So there'll be plenty of time to ask questions after that. And I'll be fielding questions from you to Lizzie. Audience members can type your questions using the Q&A function at the bottom of the screen. So please use that to do so. And you don't need to wait until the end of Lizzie's lecture to do so. Please feel free or encouraged to start putting in questions as soon as an idea comes into your head or a question comes to your mind that you'd like to pose to Lizzie later in response to her talk. So this session will be recorded and made available to the public at a later date. And should you need it or wish it, closed captioning is available. Just click the CC button on your screen to enable captions. And for those of you who might not know us that well, I just wanted to say that the Paul Mellon Centre is a research institute and educational charity that exists to support the most original and rigorous and stimulating scholarly research on British art and architecture of all periods. We endeavour to make this research as accessible as possible. And I'd urge all of you to sample and enjoy the packed array of open access online events we've put together for this autumn and winter, of which this series of lectures is just one part. Our public lecture courses, more specifically, are intended to explore and address some of the most important and engaging topics in the history of British art, and to bring these topics alive for a wide audience. This autumn series, which features a remarkable array of speakers, including artists, critics, art historians, and curators, is no exception, and promises to be both timely and enlightening. For this, I'm hugely grateful to Lizzie, who, as I say, and in collaboration with my colleague, Nermin Abdullah, has put together a wonderful programme for this autumn. Lizzie worked with Nermin and I on our last public lecture course, which was devoted to the artist William Hogarth, and for which she produced two gripping films on the ways in which the artists Lubaina Himid and Yinka Shonabari have responded to Hogarth's example. So it's a pleasure to welcome you back, Lizzie. Lizzie lectures on contemporary art in the History of Art Department at the University of Bristol, where she's currently a British Academy postdoctoral fellow working on a project entitled Making Waves, Black Artists and Black Art in Britain from 1962 to 1982. Most recently, she co-edited the pioneering exhibition publication, The Place is Here, the work of Black artists in 1980s Britain, which is a really brilliant publication, which she co-edited alongside curator Nick Aitkins. And she also co-leads the British Art Network's Black Art British Artist Research Group. So I'd like now to turn over to Lizzie, who will introduce the themes of this series and lay out the rationale and scope for what I know will be an exciting and ambitious programme of talks and conversations. So thank you, Lizzie, and over to you.
Thank you so much, Mark, for that warm welcome and very kind and generous introduction. Amazing team at the Paul Mellon Centre for organising things so brilliantly for today and for inviting me to convene this series. Before I crack on, I just want to share my screen with you. So that should now, there we go. That should be working. Somebody pop it in the chat box if it isn't. And thank you, of course, to everybody at home who's, as you join us as we embark on Black British artists and political activism, a public lecture course that, as Mark has said, comprises six sessions, which will be convened weekly, in which artists, art historians, and curators have been invited into conversation around the complex and varied relationships between art and political activism. In this, our introductory session, and excuse me, I've got the reading week cold, so I'm afraid you'll have to bear with me. In this, our introductory session, I would like to begin by mapping out some of the parameters of this series, some of the who's, what's, whys, and when's, before moving on to think through some of the issues that arise in the relationship between art and political activism in a case studies of a pair of works by the artist Rashid Areen. First and foremost, though, I'd like to acknowledge the limitations of a series that does not, because it cannot, claim or aim to engage comprehensively with the entirety of the long and complex history of the relationship between Black and Brown British artists and political activism. Rather, this series represents one set of dialogues and provocations that will, in the weeks to come, open up and work through a selection of episodes across the last century from the diverse and varied positionalities of our contributors. The series of flashpoints that this we sort of will anchor ourselves in each week will move semi-chronologically week by week, beginning with next week's investigation of the work and networks of the sculptor Ronald Moody, who moved to London from Jamaica in the early 1920s, and will conclude the series with a discussion of the artist Marlene Smith's seminal work, Good Housekeeping One, which was created and displayed in 1985 in response to the police shooting of Deborah, better known as Cherry Gross, in the same year. As such, the chronological focus of the lecture course is rooted firmly in the 20th century. And we will, in many ways, spend the coming weeks together looking back to the anti-colonial activities of Moody's networks, the anti-apartheid activisms embedded within Gavin Yetchi's early works, the politics of Black nationalism central to Keith Piper's early practice and participation in the Black art group, the history of police brutality that Smith responded to in her work, and the activisms against the passage of Section 28 and other discriminatory laws in 1988 that were documented by the photographer Ingrid Pollard. What does it mean, though, to look back when there's so much to confront in our present as artists today respond to, engage with, and make sense of the radical activities and debates of our present moment, from the ongoing fallout of the Windrush scandal, Brexit, and the COVID-19 pandemic, to the acceleration of activisms under the banner of the Black Lives Matter movement for LGBTQI+ rights, and in response to government-fueled culture wars and the global climate crisis? This is a question that vexed me as I embarked on organizing the series. While mulling this over, though, I was struck by something that the art historian Kavanagh Mercer wrote in a recent essay published in the journal Art History. And this is the cover of the special issue that that essay was published in. It was called Rethinking British Art, Black Artists, and Modernism. And it was published only this summer. And I just wanted to flag it to you now because it's currently free and accessible to all if you just head over to the Wiley Online Library. And I really recommend it. It's a really fabulous collection of scholarship. And I should say that I didn't contribute to it. So I really am just a massive fan. So in his essay titled The Longest Journey, Black Diaspora Artists in Britain, Mercer addresses a tendency towards what he refers to as presentism in art histories of Black British artists. He highlights this presentism in art historical narratives that position now as a redemptive moment for Black artists who've achieved levels of visibility and access far beyond what was possible just decades ago in what he calls the bad old days back then. Though his critique is aimed squarely, it seems, at a historiography of Black artists that produces sort of an easy linearity, this sort of easy story that runs from late modern monoculture and towards a post-colonial multiculture. It also seemed to offer a constructive way of approaching the ways in which we position our pasts and presents for our futures. To borrow from that text, rather than regard our present as a finalizing act of narrative closure, which sits apart somehow from the series of social, political, and artistic episodes that we'll encounter in this lecture course, We might set out instead to ask how today's difficulties and dissatisfactions are, as he says, descended from yesterday's predicaments, remaining unresolved in the present, but which, precisely because they are unfinalized, have a bearing on a future which is always up for grabs. We are also reminded that, as noted by David A. Bailey and Stuart Hall in a text that they wrote in 1992, that retelling involves reconstruction. History can only ever be rearticulated from within the terms and assumptions of our own time. In this way, while the shape of this course is necessarily episodic and moves across time from the interwar period to the final decades of the 20th century, we are invited to bear in mind the longer continuities and to map the links between different dimensions of struggles. How might we understand, for example, Ingrid Pollard's participation in and documentation of LGBTQI plus and Black woman activisms in the late 1980s? And how were these understandings renegotiated in her recent work, No Cover Up, at the Glasgow Women's Library, in which she gave voice to the lesbian archive by interviewing women collected in the past, by interviewing them in the present? What might Smith's Good Housekeeping look like now, after Stephen Lawrence and George Floyd, Mark Duggan and Breonna Taylor, Nicole Smallman, Bibba Henry, and on and on and on? How might we read from our present position Piper's looks to the Black nationalisms of figures such as Ron Karenga as a part of a longer and still very much ongoing trajectory of Black radical thought? And how might we frame Yanchi's shifts from political figuration of the 70s and 80s to the abstraction that we find in his more recent work? To this end, it's with great pleasure that I note that where possible, this course centers the voices of living and practicing artists, reflecting on their own processes and experiences of thinking and making at the intersections of art and political activism at different moments in careers, which are crucially ongoing and still in process. In this way, the artworks and art worlds that will come into focus in the coming weeks will necessarily be framed within a wider context of not just a series of socio-political flashpoints, but also against the backdrops of diverse, singular, and living creative praxis. Furthermore, by bringing together a polyphony of voices, this series aims to disrupt the construction of a monophonic and monovalent master narrative, a neat and linear story of art that packs it away into neat boxes, figuration here and aesthetics there, abstraction here and politics over there. The second issue that I was forced to confront early on in the series is the choice to construct a public lecture course focused on Black diaspora artists in Britain through the lens of political activism. Put simply, there is a long and troubling history of the work of Black and Brown artists bearing what Mercer has called the burden of representation. That is, the burden of representing the entirety of the communities from whence they come. And their work approached with a particular set of expectations around what it should look like, and who it might speak to, about, and for. These narratives of art history have tended to deploy complex art practices to at best examine, or worse, explain the social and political implications of race in contemporary Britain, and call upon artworks to perform a multitude of stories, to illustrate critical theories and politics of race, nation, multiculturalism, post-colonialism, and decolonization, as emblems even, of tolerance and inclusion, and so on. Here, the critic Jean Fisher's words seem particularly pertinent when she says, art does not transmit information. And art histories which seek to make visible the works of Black diaspora artists according to narrow prescriptions under the banners of inclusivity, diversity, multiculturalism, and more recently decolonization construct a problematic half story. There is, of course, though a rich field of activity in research, teaching, curating, and writing about art that challenges these narratives and seeks to attend to the work by bringing it to bear on the messiness of constituting an art history. And I'm not going to go on too much about this because I would like to sort of move into actually, you know, sort of attending to the work. But if this question of historiography is something that you're interested in, I would point you a couple of places. So again, this issue of art history, which addresses this issue really head on in a really interesting and important way. And then also to the online pages of the AHRC-funded Black Artists and Modernism's research project. I tried to log on there this morning and they seem to be down, but hopefully they'll be back up and running soon because there's a really rich set of resources arising from this research project that was headed by the artist and researcher Sonia Boyce at University of Arts London, and whose mantra was attend to the work. But this field is led in no small way by artists who research, curate, write, teach, and make, is something I find deeply interesting, but perhaps is something we could sort of dive into elsewhere. This is, of course, not a new quandary, and Stuart Hall noted in his now off-cited Ralph Samuel Memorial Lecture the difficulty of trying to make connections between the world of art and wider social histories without collapsing the former or displacing the latter. Despite the sophistication of our scholarly and critical apparatus, he asserted, we are still not very far advanced, especially when the language concerned is the visual, in finding ways of thinking about the relationship between the work and the world. We make the connection too brutal and abrupt, destroying that necessary displacement in which the work of making art takes place. In my own research, and especially my current British Academy funded project around the development of notions of Black art in Britain across the 20th century, the question that I have and continue to spend most of my time grappling with, that is, how do we meaningfully and thoughtfully make the connections of work and world that Hall outlines? And how is this complicated where the boundary between them, world and work, art and politics, wears thin, and works that are explicitly, though of course not exclusively, political? One method that I find useful is an object-based approach, that is, beginning by reckoning with a work of art, an aesthetic object in its own right, to open up some of the nuances and particularities that emerge across these frontiers. And so now briefly, I'd like to illustrate a bit of a case study that does just that. One place in which the supposed frontier between art and politics wears particularly thin is in modes of address rooted in collecting and collage. This is particularly the case in the practice and reception of artists practicing in what's come to be known as the British Black Arts Movement of the 1980s. And of course, we can see an example of that even here on this cover in a work by the artist Maud Salter. As one reviewer, this is just one example of many, as one reviewer in The Guardian noted, speaking to Black Art and Done, the 1981 exhibition organized by a coalition of emerging Black British artists, would soon call themselves the Black Art Group, and notably both Marlene Smith and Keith Piper, who we'll hear from later on in this course, participated in the Black Art Group, and Piper both organized and contributed to this show. So as we see here, the critic Irene McManus wrote, their art is really just a collection of political posters. Tied irrevocably to the racial tensions that shook British political and social life in the late 70s and 80s, the meaning and value of the strategies of collage and montage have been largely overdetermined and confined to the description of political intervention. Notably for Mercer, a shift towards a cut and mix aesthetic, that's his terminology, that he observes in Art of the 80s breaches or perforates the boundaries of sharply drawn frontiers between the message of an image and artist's concern with form. He looks to works such as this one, Piper's The Black Assassin Saints of 1982, for evidence of more porous divisions, ones that confound a binary of art and politics in artworks that speak at once the anti-racist and socialist politics of the new left, while returning to expressive modes championed by the otherwise conservative return to painting during that decade. Looking to a slightly earlier moment though, and this is where I'd like to sort of take us today, we find another seminal work which mines these porous boundaries at the interstices of work and world. This is Rashid Arin's For Oluwole. That was created between 1971 and 3, and then 1975, and it will sort of, that will all become clear, the sort of slightly strange configuration of the date in a moment. The work is frequently pinpointed as the decisive shift in Arin's oeuvre between minimalist and kinetic sculptural works, which he developed in Pakistan until moving to London via Paris in 1964, and the political conceptualism that emerged alongside his other critical and curatorial work. Looking to the processes of collecting and collage at play, we can illuminate some of the ways in which he constructs a history of art embedded with continuities and dimensions of struggle across time and place, art and politics. For Oluwole responds to the death of David Oluwole in Leeds in 1969. As a 19-year-old student with aspirations to secure a place studying engineering, Oluwole arrived in Hull as a stowaway on the Temple Star in 1949. Immediately upon disembarking, however, he was handed over to authorities and charged as a stowaway under the Merchant Shipping Act. He spent his first month in the UK in Armley Jail, Leeds, and upon his release was unable to secure a place at a technical college. By 1953, he was again imprisoned, and over the course of the following 15 years, he spent time incarcerated in psychiatric units and living on the street. Sleeping in shop doorways, he became the victim of a sustained campaign of violence from members of the Leeds City Police Force, who gave him the racist nicknames Uggy and the Lame Darky. He was beaten mercilessly, urinated on, abducted, and left to fend for himself in villages and hamlets on the far outskirts of the city and arrested on false charges several times. Accounts of the last known moments of his life, given by witnesses at the trial of the officers suspected of killing him, describe him running from police officers along the bank of the River Aire. He had been discovered sleeping rough, and the officers had begun to beat him. His battered body was pulled from the river 2 weeks later in early May of 1969. And for a more detailed account of his life and death and the trial that followed in the early 70s, there are a couple of really good resources. Among those are Peter Fryer's Staying Power, The History of Black People in Britain, which is always, I find, a very good place to start. And an article that's a little bit harder to find unless you have access to the archives, by Ron Phillips, published in Race Today, again in the early 1970s. More recently, his story has garnered renewed attention as a subject of Kester Aspin's Nationality Walk, The Hounding of David Oluwole, which was subsequently adapted into a stage play, and then again in a separate anthology of texts edited by S.J. Bradley under the title Remembering Oluwole. Interestingly, in January of this year, 2021, it was announced that the celebrated artist Ian Kishonabare has been commissioned by Leeds City Council and the Arts Council, together with the David Oluwole Memorial Association, to create a public sculpture in his memory. And so it'll be really interesting, I think, to see what Kishonabare does and and think about it in the context of this very early memorial to Oluwole. Oluwole's story resurfaced in 1971. So he was killed in 1969. The story resurfaces in 71 with a manslaughter trial of the officers involved with his death. Reading coverage of the trial, Irene was moved to make a work dedicated to him. This coincided with what Irene calls a period of identity crisis, wherein he began to lose interest in what he calls a formal art activity, to find his earlier kinetic sculptural minimalist works in favor of newfound investment in anti-colonial literature and radical Black political activities. Well, this turning point is fairly well rehearsed within the existing narrative of Irene's practice. It's vital to point out here that his political turn was not solely precipitated by events outside of the art world, the police beatings, racist political campaign, rousing post-colonial literature happening at a comfortable distance from the sacrosanct gallery space. Rather, Irene notes that what he calls his politicization really happened after he won the John Moores Prize at the Liverpool Biennale in 1969. He recalls, quote, I thought I'd made it, and my friends assumed it would then be easy for me to get gallery representation. In fact, some galleries were interested in my work, but they wouldn't exhibit it. One told me, we love your work, but we only show British and American artists. So something was wrong. During this period, alongside friend and sometimes collaborator David Madala, Irene began thinking about how he could continue to make works of art at all. Although he began to collect and store the printed material that would form the basis for Oluwole in 1971, it would remain unused several years before preparations for the exhibition Artists from Five Continents began in 1973 at London's Swiss Cottage Library. Whilst later in the decade even, Derek Boshier and John Stesiker, would go on to produce works which brought into sharp focus the right-wing media's complicity in state violence in the aftermath of the Battle of Lewisham, August 1977. Here, Irene drew on the long tradition of small-scale independent publishing on the political left as source material. For this project, he produced a panel of hardboard upon which he mounted a display of text organized into three registers. And so I'm just speaking now to the sort of panel that you see on the far left of the screen. So as you can see, the top two are made up of photocopies of an article that a small sort of handwritten note in pencil on the work indicates comes from The Guardian. While laid out like a conventional news article with a small off-center picture of Oluwole, in fact, this is effectively a small-scale collage. To produce the squarish form of the text, Green cut up and rearranged the image and text of the original article, extracting both the byline and the title, and then produced photocopies of his reworkings on a machine at the library. The bottom-most register of material that you can see there, and obviously doesn't include the photo, was the same text, but this time hand-typed for readability by Irene, who was concerned at the time that the print in the reworked newspaper article was unclear and difficult to read. Without the photograph and any of the textual structure of newsprint, here Oluwole's story takes on a personal dimension, and Irene's manual engagement with the printed material is brought to the surface. That panel hung in the library's exhibition space for a week before Irene returned to reassemble the display and add material, initiating a collage process that lasted over the 4 weeks of the exhibition. Retaining the newsprint collage, he introduced pages from the latest edition of Freedom News, detailing ongoing issues of police brutality. So those you can see now in the sort of second week, the thing titled second week panel, right there along the top. And I think I might have a, you might, yeah, I think you could probably see it a little better there. A short-lived publication by the British Black Panthers, Freedom News, arose from a growing post-war Black press that included major titles like Race Today and numerous sort of small pamphlets and newsletters. There's some really interesting scholarship on this actually as well. By 1973, as a member of the British Black Panthers, Irene participated in the production and dissemination of Freedom News and other publications, allowing him to collect material for use in his art practice. The headlines blare, "Police riot in Brockwell Park, police terror must stop," above images of Black men in handcuffs or showing injuries sustained at the hands of the British state. Interspersed with printed images of Black fists and salute, the conventions of the broadsheets give way to the aesthetics of the small-scale print tradition of the radical left. Calls for action in the present, drawn into conversation with a tragic outcome of action not taken years before. To this continuity of struggle across time, as the panel changed over the following weeks, Oluwole's story was replaced by other found material, such as leaflets and photocopy news articles protesting anti-colonial and anti-racist struggles in the UK and further afield. In the third week, and this is a close-up of that panel, the panels began to address the contemporary visit of Portugal's then Prime Minister, Marcelo Caetano, to London, culminating in celebrations of the sexcentenary of the Anglo-Portuguese Alliance. The visit was marked by both official cultural displays of national friendship and unofficial public protests. Produced by the End the Alliance campaign, the leaflets advertising some of these protests that Irene collected for his display decried the ongoing wars of liberation in Portugal's then colonial states that took place across the 60s and 70s. Sorry. And so those are the, and the Alliance ones are obviously the sort of yellow ones, and that's towards the middle on the sides there, sort of bookends. Like the Guardian article that Irene preserved for several years before creating For Oluwole, it's notable that the Alliance leaflets here reappear in a slightly later work as well. The 1974 work, No Politics, Please. In this work, the leaflets create a rectangular field on a red painted board, overlaid by a poster. Collected in the previous year, the poster advertises the British Museum's 600 years of Anglo-Portuguese alliance, an exhibition which was exhibited contemporaneously with the Swiss Cottage Show. Unlike the carefully placed elements of For Oluwole, the poster has sections torn from it, underscoring the physicality of Irene's intervention and recalling the palimpsest textures of streetscape detritus, summoning leaflets and posters haphazardly layered on top of each other, becoming sun-bleached and torn over time. Here, however, Irene's layers speak to each other across time and space. Although the title of the exhibition is legible, the only other semi-complete section of the poster is an illumination from a late 15th century edition of the, and I'm going to butcher the French here, of the Ancien et Nouvelle Chronique d'Angleterre manuscript depicting the royal marriage that secured England's relationship with Portugal. At the center of the poster, and you know, so which obviously was exhibited and is held by the British Library. At the center of the poster, these torn sections reveal a black and white photocopy of a found image. While difficult to distinguish immediately, given both the print quality of the reproduction and the areas of green poster that partially and irregularly cover the surface, it clearly depicts the mutilation of dead black bodies by what are identified by their uniforms as Portuguese soldiers. The bodies of soldiers and victims, clergy and aristocracy drift in and out of focus. Histories are entangled as then and now come to bear on the here and there. With the links circuits of colonial and neocolonial power and the industry of culture lay bare, the futility implied in Irene's title is clear. In the final week of the display, so now it's the rightmost image, the Alliance material was supplemented by further pages of that week's Freedom News. So over and over, we see sort of new editions of Freedom News being placed. And one of the interesting things I've not sort of written into the talk, but that I find very interesting, is that there were different editions of Freedom News for different parts of the country, and indeed even different sort of local areas of London. And so Irene uses his sort of local North London edition, but again, there were other ones sort of circulating. So again, there's this really interesting thing of time and also the particularities of place. So among the sort of stories in that week's Freedom News were coverage of resistance to racist immigration policies, which themselves made use of a well-known photograph in the marches against the 1962 immigration bill. Another layer of meaning and imagery added into the historical continuities mapped by Irene. We find the artist's hand at work with a handwritten text appended to an article which encourages viewers to organize to fight for a decent home. Other material includes photocopies of articles from the Free Palestine newspaper, accompanied by a hand-typed passage calling attention to the flow of arms from the UK to Israel. Again, Irene plays in the interstices of time and place and here and there. The institutional spaces and voices of art galleries, museums, and broadsheet newspapers, and the political material spaces of activism that his work sought to occupy. In subsequent exhibitions, beginning with works 1965 to 1975, which unsurprisingly was staged in 1975, he reactivated the 1973 material by recreating each of the panels, but this time displaying them side by side. The movement through time from week to week. So, you know, again, when this is exhibited at Swiss Cottage, it's a single panel that gets sort of done, redone. But subsequently, it's displayed in this way, where that movement of time from week to week is translated into movement across space. As Irene's physical intervention, the work is memorialized in what now becomes a sort of static object. The political activities and activisms that were once contemporaneous to the work's exhibition, documenting the dynamic social and political world happening outside of the library in the summer of 1973, are now fixed as a material history of the recent past and the artist's relationship to it. Crucially, however, for Irene, this fixity is disrupted continuously by the implications of time and space within hegemonies of art and knowledge. Echoing Bailey and Hall's statement that I referred to earlier around the rearticulation of the past and the present, he asserts that ideas as knowledge can always be salvaged from history, given a new context and made to move forward within the dynamic of new time and space. And so nearly 20 years after Irene began to collect material around the death of Oluwole, he salvaged the events of 1969, 1971, and 1973. In this work, For Oluwole 2, which was created in 1988, and which incidentally was also recently exhibited together with the original work at the Tetley in an exhibition there rooted in the memory of Oluwole. In this work, each of the original four panels have been photographed, and the color and texture of the collage is flattened into the grayscale of reproduction. The original reconstructions of the Guardian article are rendered even more blurry through being copied and recopied and resized. Details are lost in reconstruction. However, with the addition of two new panels, and so these are the two middle panels, Sorry. Irene brings others to the surface. The first new panel is a hand-typed text by the artist. So this is the one on the left-hand side, introducing the story of Oluwole and outlining the technical and critical processes behind the 1973 work. The emphasis on the importance of infiltrating the gallery space as a location for bourgeois aesthetic assumptions with actual reality, which were clearly articulated in that panel, comes to life in its neighbor, the second new edition. So this is the one on the right. And here's a slightly better image. Here we find another enlarged text, this time an anonymous letter of complaint sent to the visual arts director of the Swiss Cottage Library in response to the 1973 exhibition. In the letter, Hampstead resident, so this sort of anonymous letter, expresses their dismay that the painting intended for exhibition had been displaced by, quote, a copy of a newspaper called the Freedom News Special, highlighting the paper's connection to the Black Workers Movement, which they note was formerly the British Black Panther Party. The writer condemns the publication as hate propaganda and appeals to the library to remove, quote, this offensive publication as quickly as possible, especially in light of its proximity to its children's section. So you might be able to read it for a moment. It's really interesting, sort of, I guess in a scholarly sense, this anonymous person sort of spends quite a lot of time talking about how when they were a child, they were taught to trust the police, and isn't it wrong that we're showing our children that, you know, the police aren't to be trusted? And there's a lot of symmetries, obviously. A lot of these, history's not over, obviously. What I find really notable and interesting, though, is that the writer fails to register for Oluwole as an artwork at all, and describes it rather as a bare display of political text, an example of political activism of Black Britons, though pointedly that term is not used, boldly, quote, putting their case in the public library. In this way, the 1973 made space for social and political realities within an art space, using the language of modernist formalism to address the material realities of colonial and neocolonial subjects. Yet in 1988, Irene would come to reckon with the forces that seek to control the work and the world and the spaces between them. Forces which were brought into sharp focus in his 1978 seminal text, A Preliminary Notes for Black Manifesto, in which he wrote in all capital letters, the door which is shut in our face by a white landlady is also the door which opens to the art establishment. So at this point, I'd like to start to draw some conclusions, though as this is an introduction, maybe this isn't the best place for conclusions. So maybe we can call them sort of a direction for travel as we anticipate next week's session and all of those that follow. In the coming weeks, I look forward to with you and with our fabulous lineup of contributing speakers, the ways in which this relationship between the work and the world, art and political activism, examined with such nuance by Irene, might be negotiated and renegotiated over time and across different artistic practices and spaces. It is from an inherently polyvalent and polyvocal approach that this series invites us to think through the frontiers of art and political activism in the past, in the present, and for the future. Next week, then, we'll be joined by the scholar, archivist, and mixed media artist, Ago Sawinski, who will share with us her research on the works and highly active political networks of the sculptor Ronald Moody. And you can book your tickets for that if you haven't already on the PMC's website. In the meantime, though, I welcome any questions that you might have for me. Thank you. Oh. There we go. See what's coming.
Thanks so much, Lizzie. That was really a brilliant introduction to the series. And please gather your thoughts, everyone, those of you watching. And I'd really appreciate it. And I know Lizzie would really appreciate it if you could think of a question or that to respond to either that case study that Lizzie focused on of Irene's for Oluwole work, or a question in relation to the broader themes that Lizzie outlined and issues that she outlined in the first half of her lecture. So while we're waiting for some questions to come in, and again, I'd really encourage you to ask anything that that struck you about the presentation. I'd love to focus in myself, Lizzie. I'm sorry you've got such a troublesome cough and cold, but you've done brilliant to get through things. Can you just talk a bit about, I'm really intrigued by this work, the Irene work, and maybe to, there's two questions. One quite specific question, which is very interesting about the ways in which he reconfigures the board week by week, and the models for that kind of practice in artistic practice. So, I mean, where do you find, what's he sort of building that idea of regular reassemblage, kind of weekly reassemblage on? Is it based on the rhythms of news and of the newspaper, or are there some really interesting artistic precedents or models that you can see him operating with there? And I guess that leads to a broader question, which is at the heart of the course in some ways, is that relationship between aesthetics and of form, which you touched on in that work, to the narratives of activism. And it'd be really interesting if you could talk about the ways in which one might read that object or engage with that object formally and aesthetically, or whether that was, or the issues around that kind of approach to an object like that one on Irene's part.
Thank you so much. Yeah, I mean, that's sort of the thing, isn't it? That's the thing that I think about most of the time. Yeah, how do we do that thing where we read these really complex works as both political works, which are political and which would speak to the world very explicitly, but which are also, yeah, these really complex practices which speak to art histories and sort of contemporary practice. And one of the things I find so interesting about Rashid Arian is that the way that he conceives things like the grid, for example. So, that's sort of the history of the modernist grid in sort of avant-garde practice as being really rich and sort of quite well established. Sorry, give me one second. I realize that the baby monitor is on in this room. I hear my toddler screaming. Give me two moments.
Excitements and pleasures of a Zoom webinar, everyone. But while Lizzie's away, again, we've got already got a really interesting question from Jennifer Sarathy coming in, but more would be very welcome. Yeah, sorry, Lizzie.
Sorry. The joys of children. And being at home. So thinking about sort of the grid that Irene plays with, and that sort of idea of symmetry that we see him engaging with, both, across the sort of layout, but then also this symmetry of coming back, and that's a ritual, is he writes really incisively about how he sees symmetry as a sort of political statement, and he finds symmetry in the sort of ways in which politics orders life. Mm-hmm. And so in that way, this idea of sort of these formalist techniques arising from, forms of modernism, which are sort of untouched by the concerns of the world, in his practice, he thinks about that in a really interesting way. So actually this idea that, I realize not everybody's necessarily so very well acquainted with his work, but he begins by doing these really amazing sculptures. He's sort of very inspired by Anthony Caro and really interested in sort of minimalism. And again, that sort of idea of symmetry. So what I find so interesting is the way that those sort of aesthetic devices become political devices for him. And so I think, In his practice, and I think in most practices, you can't really, to try and divorce the idea of art and politics is a real problem. Yeah. You just end up telling one half story instead of the other half story.
I have one more question which follows on from that, but then we'll certainly turn to our audience because we're getting some really interesting questions coming in now. I mean, it's really interesting you talk. I mean, this might seem a strange link or an accidental one, but there's force to it. I mean, it is interesting that you dealt with Hogarth and with responses to Hogarth in your last public lecture presentations for us, Lizzie. And one of the ways in which collage can be understood as it's been mobilized in 20th century visual culture is as a kind of form of radical satire that because satire is a pictorial satire is and collage always seem to have this, they have one foot in the field of the fine arts or of the art world or of visual culture. And then they have satire certainly, and collage in many ways also has a foot in the world of print culture and journalism. And here you get a practice that seems to exactly be pulling those worlds into collision. And it seems to build on a notion of a kind of, you can understand it in relation to a lineage of radical satire, which is about a critique of an established order from a position of an outsider or of someone with a very very critical perspective on that order. So it's interesting that there is a kind of there's a way in which you can relate Irene's practice very squarely in relation to even the traditions of collage and satire, and it's interesting in that way in which he does these weekly reassemblages of his critique. I mean, in many ways, for me, looking back over the history of satire, that satirists would regularly do these kind of installments where they would, on a weekly basis, attack using the visual tools at their disposal. And again, the rhetoric of journalism to attack certain politicians or political orders.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, thank you. I think you're absolutely right that there is that, you know, that sort of set of lineage is that he's tapping into. So it's that sort of more public sort of sphere of satire. And then also, the sort of the political avant-garde, thinking about people like Hannah Hocke, mm-hmm. and the way that that collage is used in sort of across the 20th century to speak very powerfully mm-hmm. To politics. And as you say, across this line of art and formalism and aesthetics. And I think I don't know, as a contemporary specialist, I do often find myself, you might appreciate sort of going back to Hogarth and just thinking there is, as you say, there's so much here, but Hogarth is somebody that really understood the power of media and the power of the sort of the satirical image and the ways in which we use reproduction and mechanical reproduction, all these things. Mm-hmm. Okay. I think Irene is definitely a part of that. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Let's turn to some questions that we're receiving from our audience, and thanks to those who've submitted them. The first is from Jennifer Sarathy, and Jennifer asks, I was wondering if you could speak more about Irene's relationship to alternative media like the Freedom News. I wonder how the circulation of this media again expands the movement across space that you describe.
Thank you, Jennifer. So the Freedom News, as I said, was published by the Black Workers Movement, which had previously been the British Black Panther Party. And Irene was a member of the party and involved in the publication of the Freedom News. so I think he was sort of quite intimately involved with that press. He's really highly engaged in the sort of radical politics at this moment. Mm-hmm. It's a close relationship. It's I think probably quite a personal relationship. And I wonder how the circulation of this media expands the movement across space. This is something to me that I find really interesting, because I think, thinking to sort of no politics, please, the thing that immediately springs to mind is, I think you probably don't see it very much anymore these days, but if you go to sort of bus stops or train stops sort of loads of stickers and posters and things, sort of all, the ways in which they all layer up on each other. And that's really you know, this idea that these elements of activism move across each other and across time and across space, and we, you know, are sort of circulated locally and to some extent, because as I said before, like the Freedom News had different editions for different sort of local communities. you know, sort of like you know, sort of your sort of local paper. I was going to give my local example, but I realized not many of you are probably in Bristol, so it might not make sense. Yeah, so there's that sort of the specificity on the one hand, but then, you know, as this moves across time and space, so, you know, sort of out of Swiss Cottage and out of North London, you know, and thinking even more recently, so that work was exhibited in the places here, exhibitions that Nick Akins curated, you know, and as it moved in 2017 to the Netherlands or to Birmingham or to, you know, all these different venues, the ways in which those particularities and specificities are then sort of expanded and made to speak to other localities in unique ways. Sorry, that's very long.
That raises that final point you made, raises a really interesting question about the ways in which this work has been framed and received and critically responded to across its history and across its different iterations. I mean, it sounds like the one response it received in the early 1970s was from that Hampstead resident. But I mean, whether there was any kind of critical or art critical response at that point at all to that show, I mean, in a Swiss Cottage library, I wonder even the fact that it was in that kind of space rather than in a more established gallery space, that unless there was something quite interesting going on there in relation to the libraries and art space. But then what's happened to the ways in which that work has been understood in these subsequent iterations? I mean, and the kind of the broader story that tells about your subject, really, about that relationship between Black British artists and activism is quite an interesting one.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think one of the things I find really interesting is that in some worlds, this is a really massive and important work. So as early as, I can't remember the publication date, I want to say 1985, six, right there, sort of mid-80s, Rashid and Eddie Chambers publish a conversation about Black art together. And Eddie Chambers, who's an art historian and an artist who's also involved in the Black Art Movement, you know, in case you know, people at home aren't familiar with him, he's written some really fabulous books that you should definitely read. Eddie calls this work the first Black artwork created in Britain, which is really, you know, that's registering at that time is massive. But again, it's sort of, what I find really interesting is that there's this sort of world, and it's predominantly peopled by artists who are not just making work, but also writing about it, building the critical frameworks about it, exhibiting it. Somebody I saw in the chat earlier referred to the Black Art Gallery. So, you know, it's sort of, yeah, these sort of spaces which, in which this work was really important. But I mean, within a wider picture of British art history, this work didn't really register, you know, other than, you know, the fact that it was a part of an Artist for Democracy, you know, it's sort of lumped in with this sort of moment in the 70s where the sort of new, you know, the left did a bunch of crazy things. And this is an example.
Okay. We have a question from Jack Gardner, who says, great talk, Lizzie, thank you. How do you suggest we approach Irene's earlier and less and later less political work? Should we take into context his period of explicit political engagement, or should they be looked at distinctly from a more formalist approach?
Thank you, Jack. So how should we approach his, Well, this is one of the things I find really interesting about Irene, is that he writes so much about practice, both his own practice and sort of a wider art history. And so across this sort of critical practice that runs parallel with the visual practice, he talks, you know, again about the ways in which the formal is political. And so this idea that this sort of notion that yokes sort of figuration or collage or text or, you know, these sort of different visual strategies with politics, he sort of disrupts that and says, well, actually, you know, again, sort of symmetry is political, you know, in the way that governments exert symmetry to exert control, you know, that symmetry is a form of control, and in the same, and he sort of really neatly draws that line, you know, again, this idea that the door that slams in the face of the person being discriminated against in terms of housing is the same door that slams the artist out of the art world. So I think this is the crux of it, really, for me, and that's that a formalist approach that doesn't attend to the sort of holistic thing that's happening, which includes politics and which includes, yeah, as Stuart Hall says, this relationship between the work and the world, is, I think, just, I don't, not great art history, I think.
One, because this has just been a great introduction. It's a kind of a fantastic platform for the rest of the series, this talk, Lizzie. It'd be great to hear your thoughts on how you decided on the topics that you've ended up choosing, and what and whether in does the story or the different stories you tell through this program, to your eyes, offer something very different to a standard narrative about the relationship between Black British artists and political activism, or is that narrative not yet been developed? And so this is very much a pioneering attempt to try and do that. It'd be great to get your sense of the choices you made and how it relates to an existing set of histories.
Thank you. Well, I think one of the things that I find really exciting is that this history is being written. So as I said before, you know, sort of beginning, you know, really early on with art, you know, even, you know, if you think back to people like Francis Newton Souza, Frank Bowling, of course, Rashid, Irene, Eddie Chambers, Ubaid Hamid, Sonia Boyce, you know, across the 20th century, so much of this work has been done by the artists themselves. And what I find really exciting is that, you know, of course, also a number of art historian theorists like Stuart Hall, Kavanagh Mercer, you know, amongst many others who have been doing this work for a while now and doing it really brilliantly. What I find really exciting is that right now there's sort of a surge of activity, and I'm really excited to be part of that, in which it seems like there's sort of a next generation of art historians. I think there's sort of a numbers thing as well. There's more of us that are doing some of this work. And what I hope that this series, so what I find quite interesting as you watch this happen is the ways in which this history is becoming written and the processes of how history is written and what happens. And when you start to see sort of that story starting to crystallize of what bits were important and what bits weren't important, and who are we going to write about and who aren't we going to write about? Who are we going to include in the exhibitions and who aren't we going to include? And you do start, and you know, you see that process in real time. And so what I'm hoping to do in this series is by inviting lots of different people to participate. So instead of just me sort of speaking to you across six, sort of telling this story, what I hope we brought to bear is all of these different points of views and experiences, and the ways in which those points of views and experiences have changed over, you know, sort of 30, 40 years. Again, to sort of create an art history. And I think this is one of us, personally as a scholar, what I find really exciting and important is an art history that is polyvalent, you know, which is located and comes from and speaks to and from different places. So that's what I'm really excited about. So we've got lots of conversations. And then to your question about how I thought about the different sessions, it was really quite difficult. And I had lots of sort of ideas and backups in case one didn't work, then we could do this other topic. And yeah, it was a lot. But I think what I wanted to do was try to look at these sort of quite big moments and so big issues, and to see what we could do if we looked at them again through that sort of lens of the specific. So thinking about this really pressing issue, and obviously again it's been in the news only this week around the ways in which the police treat Black and brown folks. How do you address that in a lecture? I don't know. I don't, how do you, the ways in which artists have dealt with and reckoned with that. And so I thought, the best way to do that, I thought, and to do it with care and to try and draw out some nuances by asking an artist, in this case, Marlene Smith, to speak to a work inspired by one very quite famous, but certainly not sort of only instance of documented police brutality. Does that make sense?
Yeah, no, it makes a huge amount of sense. And just one last really interesting observation that's coming from Caroline Osborne about actually the Swiss Cottage Library, and of course, which is the setting for that first display. Caroline talks about the fact that that library held many controversial exhibitions at the stage, including the 1973 Woman Power Show, which was closed by the police for showing a picture of a woman giving birth, titled God Giving Birth. Shows tended to get reviewed in places like Time Out, Caroline mentioned. So again, that points to the kind of intersectionality of this story, doesn't it? That this is, what's going to be so exciting is to think about the ways in which so many of the issues and the imagery that you're looking at engage or operate in dialogue with a whole range of other kinds of critical art practice of the kind that Caroline's just been talking about here. And, yeah. the settings for these displays is really fascinating. And it segues into that discussion we had in the British Art Network Summer Conference on the genealogies of black curating and black art. And again, the role that artists played in curating shows of this kind of practice through this period. Great. Well, thanks so much, Lizzie. Many thanks to you. Thanks to the PMC team who helped support this. You've given us a great introduction, a great launching pad for the series, and we can't wait for next week. I invite everyone who's been watching to not only to return, but to tell their friends and colleagues about the series, because we've got some really fantastic talks coming up. So really looking forward to that. And thanks again, Lizzie, for a great introduction.
Thanks, everyone. Thanks, Mark.